My name is David Skidmore. I'm a professor of political science here and also director of our principal financial group, Center for Global Citizenship, which is sponsoring tonight's event. And we do events, 30 to 40 events throughout the year. So I hope you'll come back to some of our upcoming events. On November 16th at 7 in the evening, we'll be having a talk by Vandana Shiva, who is globally famous voice on green agriculture and a kind of a critic of industrial agriculture. So she's going to talk to us a little bit about our food system and how we get our food and how we might be able to do it differently and better. That, by the way, I don't want to claim sole sponsorship on that. There are many different organizations that have chipped in as possible, but the initiating organization was Drake Environmental Action League student group. So that's very exciting. And if you go to our webpage, you'll see other opportunities to learn about international events. And I'm happy that you came and joined us tonight. I know that we have some competition on campus because IPTV is doing an election-oriented panel discussion. But tonight's event really comes out of an event that I went to, sponsored by Rotary International. It was sort of an international summit. They brought together nonprofit organizations in Central Iowa who are doing work that connects Iowa to the world. And a number of the organizations that I would learn about there were, in fact, working on engagement between Iowans and various countries on the African continent. And a lot of it was new to me, and it occurred to me that it might be surprising to folks here at Drake and in the community to realize just how much and how deep the engagement really is. And some of the stories that you'll hear tonight from the folks on the panel who are involved with these various organizations located some here and one actually in Uganda, I think you'll also find these to be very interesting and positive stories. So, and some of the organizations are ones that you might have an interest in getting involved in. So, and if that were the case, then perhaps you could follow up by chatting afterwards with some of our panelists or exploring some of their web materials. So our topic is Iowa and Africa expanding engagement, and the format will be very simple. I'm going to allow each panelist to give a brief overview of the mission of their organization, what kind of activities that they're engaged in, and what they've learned from their experience building ties between Iowa and Africa. And those will be fairly short so that we leave plenty of time for questions and answers, and I hope that as you hear these stories, you'll be thinking of questions you want to ask to learn more about these organizations and the great work that they're doing. So let me very briefly just introduce the panelists, and then we'll just go in the order from this end of the panel to the other end. And so I'll introduce each in turn very quickly. Eric Edehin is sitting just to my right. He is the founder and CEO of Cornerstone of Hope Orphanage in Nigeria. Yes. And then just to Eric's right is Moses Bomet, who is president and founder of Hopeful Africa and also happens to be a Drake graduate. And then to his right is my boss, I call her, Anit Keel. Of Drake University, who is executive director of our global engagement and international programs here at Drake. Phil Latessa is the executive director of Empower Tanzania. Dale Christensen is the executive director of Iowa Resource for International Service. Dave Mershman is president of Medicine for Mali. And Francis Kamuhanda is the founder and leader of Sure Prospects Institute in Uganda and he gets the award for coming the furthest to join us tonight, all the way from Uganda via Western Michigan, I guess. So Eric, would you like to start us off? We have microphones here that we can pass around, and some folks have slides, others do not.
I do not have slides because I believe 5 minutes is not enough for me to even call my name. If I need to tell you what my name means. It's nice to be here. Thank you for the opportunity. My organization's name is Cornerstone of Hope Orphanage. What we do is providing adequate love and care for orphans. I grew up in Nigeria. I left the country many years ago. I spent some time in Europe before I moved to the United States about 16 years ago. I moved to Des Moines. Growing up poor in Africa, I thought life was difficult. But what I'm trying to do today is look at this world through the eye of the orphan. So what that means is we provide, we try to change lives, you know, share love and build hope for orphans. And by providing them a house is not enough. By giving them food is not enough. By giving them clothing is not enough. My goal is not to have a warehouse of kids. My goal is to provide adequate love and care for them and prepare them for a happy home. And we have been able to place 76 children in happy homes for 10 years that we have been in existence. So for 10 years, we have 76 children living with families. Out of the 76, we have 13 of them in in the United States. We have 13 of them. And out of the 13, we have 2 in Iowa. One of them is our daughter. So my wife and I, we have 3 biological boys. They are 15, 16, 17 years old. But we have a girl that we adopted. She's 9 years old. She came to the United States this January. So she's in elementary school. She's loving life. And the other boy is in Stories, Orange City in Iowa. So those are the 2 we have here. That is the connection I have. It used to be very easy for people to go over there and adopt children, but there are so many red tapes. And every year the government keeps changing the laws. So it's been very difficult for me to have my fellow Iowans go over to Nigeria to adopt. So what we did was, because my wife and I, we have dual nationalities, so we adopted her as Nigerians, and then we brought her home as Americans. It was very easy for us, and it was cheaper. We need help. We need money. We need everything you can think about. But because today there's no fundraising, I was told, I'm not going to talk about money. I'm only going to talk about time, and I'm also going to talk about talent. There are so many ways you can help. One of the things that opened my eyes the most is when a high school graduate in Ohio went to the orphanage in Nigeria, she is the one that helped us discover the emotional torture that orphans go through. Oh, here you go, you have a big house, you have nice clothes, you have food, you go to private school, you're good, right? But the emotional side of it never occurred to me. But this girl from Ohio, who is now an adult, she's a graduate now, she discovered that some of the older kids at the orphanage were going through certain emotional unbalance. And we had to now put resources into that. And that led us to one of the victory today. The oldest boy at the orphanage, who's been with us for 10 years, thought something was wrong with him because nobody comes for adoption to even call his name. They always go for the younger children. So that older kid is going to come to school in Canada and University of Winnipeg. I think that's how they call it. Winnipeg, Manitoba, in Canada. So I'm still trying to learn that name because these are new to me. I know after 5 minutes, so I'm going to...
By the way, Manitoba is very, very cold.
Yes.
Just to know.
I told him that he doesn't care. He just wants to come to North America. And by the way, you know, kids in Africa, we see North America as heaven. So he said he's going to better deal with the cold than remain in an orphanage in Africa. Well, he's not going to be there after this year because it's already, he's through high school. He's 18 years old, gonna be 19 in December. He's supposed to be on his own now. But we chose to want to make him cornerstone, because that's why we got our name, making the rejected stone become cornerstone, so that they can go help other rejected stone to become, you know, successful people. If we all can do that, this world will be a better place. So, thank you.
Thank you, Eric.
I'll be here for questions.
Thank you. My name is Moses Bomet, and I am with Hopeful Africa. And my experience comes from where my family is from. I was born here in the United States, but I grew up in Africa. After I was 2 years old, I moved to Kenya. And so a lot of my experiences was spent in the school system. And that's when I came to the United States to finish my high school education, that I saw some of those disparities between things that might relate in my country, Kenya, and maybe even other African countries as well. And so education is something I speak highly of. And I saw that there was a lot of effort that was being put to help Africa, but there were band-aid solutions. And I really wanted to do something a little bit more long-term and sustainable. And so we focused on education. And currently, we work with 7 schools in Africa. These are all rural public schools. And we help provide whatever they need to be able to do what they need to do. And that means it could be books, it could be adding more teachers, it could be providing student sponsorship, it could be all sorts of things. But we want to work with them to be able to achieve what they need to achieve. And our mission, simply put, is to foster sustainable prosperity in Africa through educational development and equal partnership. Those are two things that mean so much. I can probably say, even for us Africans, is sometimes people come to help but don't necessarily listen to the problems or the challenges we face. And it's key to talk to the locals and find out what that is, so you can be able to have a sustainable solution. Our schools love that we let them pick what they need and solve the problems they have, but we simply come in to just partner with them to give them the support they need to get where they need to be. So thank you for having me this evening, and I look forward to answering some of the questions you have.
Well, I'm the first panelist to have slides, so I'm going to skip over here to the end.
Oh, no, order.
Someone else.
Can we just skip you and come back to
me?
Okay. Bill, are you, who's?
No, this is Aristotle.
Oh,
you
have a slide?
Go ahead.
My name is Bill Latessa. I'm the executive director of Empower Tanzania. We're a volunteer organization. We're founded in 2008, and we work in 2 districts in the northeastern part of the country, about 400,000 people. That's our current territory, and we expect and hope to expand out through eventually the rest of the country. We work mainly in education, development, and healthcare. Those are really broad areas, and under those we do specific kinds of projects. And I'll just describe one of them to let you know generally what we're about. I want to thank Moses for the reminder that any time you go and do anything over there, the first thing you should be doing is listening. We learned early on that that's the critical factor in any kind of program that's going to have any results. And so our goal is never fly over with an idea that we're going to drop off. We always go over with notebooks and ask the folks what they need. And then it's a matter of negotiating what's possible to try to meet that need. The project I'll describe is one that's related to a major emphasis that we undertook several years ago. And that is essentially empowering women. Our programs focus primarily on women as the people who do the programs. Some of you probably know that internationally, that probably here in the US, that's the only way anything gets done. Women are the ones who make things happen in that country. And so that leads to some cultural issues, since it's such a male-dominated society. And we have to work carefully with the women involved in our programs to make sure that they don't run into problems at home. But they're very successful and very creative. And the particular program I want to talk to you about came about Some 40 years ago, the government of Tanzania began forcibly evicting the Maasai from around the, what they later became the game parks. That was their territory for grazing their cattle from many thousands of years. But with the advent of increased amounts of tourism, the Maasai were in the way. So they followed what we did in the United States here in the 1800s, and that's moved the natives to some really not so good places in the country to live. In our district, the Maasai, there are probably 40 or 50,000 of them, and they're out in the most remote parts of the territory. And Tanzania does not have a lot of great infrastructure, and so most of the roads that exist are dirt roads, and this is a mountainous area, so it's a difficult terrain to get around. But these Maasai communities are not even on roads, and so we found that they had great need for most any kind of services, and our medical group decided that they would undertake a program. And so we visited 21 of these villages, each of which the elders agreed to participate and identified one of the married women in the tribe to participate in the program. We gathered them together, and with the aid of Tanzanian medical staff and some of our own clinical people, first thing we did was teach them how to do first aid and how to connect people that they were treating to the nearest health facility. And sometimes those are quite a few miles away, but we had set up these referral arrangements which hadn't existed before. The second year, they got some retraining, but this time we focused on education. And each of them was given an iPad with about 30 health education videos preloaded, all in Swahili. And these are charged, the batteries are charged by solar collectors because of course there's no power out there. And it turns out this is the only entertainment that happens in the villages at night, so they're all learning about hand washing and why they should use the mosquito nets and a variety of other useful products. That's been a very interesting activity, and this is just illustrative of the kind of things that we do. We work at the very base, the local community level. One of the things we're very interested in doing is building a lot more energy and support among young people. And as a start towards that, we have an arrangement with Drake University. Two of the pharmacy undergraduates just spent 4 weeks there working on some specific programs for us. And we're talking about next year, another group going back probably in the summertime to do whatever else turns out to be useful at the time. So this, you can learn a lot more about us. I've left some brochures out there, and our website is empowertz.org. Thanks.
Let's see if I'm working this the right direction. We'll find out after the first slide. Hi, everybody. My name is Dell Christensen. I'm the Executive Director of Iowa Resource for International Service. It's also known as IRIS, but Iowa Resource for International Service was founded by a former Lieutenant Governor Bob Anderson back in 93, and the name really says it all. We utilize Iowa resources to serve the world. Since its inception, IRIS has worked with nearly 2,000 participants from 52 different countries around the world. While we do work around the world, a lot of the work that we've done in the last 15 years has been in sub-Saharan Africa. Our Africa focus has been threefold, working with youth, women, and health issues. And much as Phil had mentioned, if you wanted find some change agents in those rural communities, look to the youth, look to the women, because that's where change is going to happen. The youth programs that we've done have focused on education as well as instilling a spirit of volunteerism. IRIS helped to establish that. IRIS helped to establish the first State Department funded high school exchange program called Youth Exchange and Study, or YES. And we select students from Nigeria and Tanzania and have placed students in to come to the U.S. And we place students in Iowa from any of 40 different countries through that program. Since we started that, working with that program in 2003, we've brought over more than 500 students that have come to Iowa from countries such as Nigeria, Tanzania, Mali, Cameroon, Senegal, Kenya, Mozambique, Ghana, Liberia, South Africa, Morocco, Tunisia, and Egypt. But while the students are in the U.S., in addition to studying, they learn about community service, and they take that volunteer spirit back home with them. And a lot of these countries, the whole concept of community service and volunteerism isn't second nature like it is here in the U.S. And so it's thrilling to watch those alumni go back home and encourage other youth to get involved in projects. And in many cases, they will organize and fund those projects on their own. But IRIS also provides a global grants program that helps them with some of the larger projects. And sometimes we actually work with larger partners to make really big projects. So back in 2011, IRIS worked with Drake University, with Tec de Monterrey in Mexico, as well as Global Football, to orchestrate the Global Kilimanjaro Bowl. Football teams from Drake and Tec de Monterrey in Mexico played the first ever American college football game on the continent of Africa in Arusha, Tanzania. But more importantly, those teams worked with our YES alumni and local communities to do a number of volunteer projects and youth sports clinics. And then at the end of their stay, the two teams climbed Mount Kilimanjaro together in a show of international unity. Our women's programs have focused on education, empowerment, and developing leadership skills, especially as it relates to civic engagement. In 2007 and 2008, we brought over a number of women from Nigeria who had political aspirations, and they came and they learned how to set up political campaigns and run political campaigns and get more women involved in the political process back in Nigeria. Our health programs have included the first ever Pan-African community health education workshop in Senegal, which occurred just last year. It included participants from 12 different African countries, and the instructor and the person that developed the curriculum for this program is Drake's own professor, Dr. Deborah Christensen. We should note that last year, we were still on the heels of the Ebola outbreak in West Africa, so a lot of the focus through community health education was how can the local folks come up with ideas that will help address those local community issues that relate to Ebola as well as other health issues in West Africa. And our most recent health project that we've got going is this year. We worked on a partnership program working with Rotary Clubs in Iowa and Nigeria. We worked with the faculty at Des Moines University to train medical professionals from Nigeria who are now back in Nigeria teaching nurses, midwives, and traditional birthing attendants different birthing skills, and using these very low-tech birthing simulator mannequins. And we continue to look each year for new projects to do and additional countries to work in throughout Africa. But our focus will always be youth, women, and health as we work through those areas. And we always will continue to utilize Iowa resources to make those things happen. So I appreciate the time and look forward to answering any questions you might have. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Francis Kamuhanda, and I always like to explain my last name, Kamuhanda, which is a person born on the way. I'm a person with a disability, born way far back in 1976, and my mother took care of me as a child with a disability to have first priority. In Africa, once somebody has a disability, they think you are a waste, you are a curse to the community, you can do nothing, and you'll have a series of names. But my mother did do that. people will come to thank her for giving birth to a newborn baby, but they would say, but he's disabled, sorry, it's a pity that you have lost such a handsome young boy. But I was alive and breathing, but that is the connotation that people give. And as you look at these pictures here, I was born here in this village. So when I went to Kampala in 1998 to join Makerere University, I find so many people with disabilities on the streets. And I asked myself, what happened? They don't have mother, they didn't have mothers, or, and I thought something was going wrong. So when I finally graduated from the university, I thought I should do something that would create a direct impact that does not need statistical methods of measuring, but you just look at it and you see change. So I decided to focus on young children that have disabilities, and the only intervention I thought if they had education. So I decided to look at young children, give them education, and then I see how we progress. My first school was under the avocado tree, where I came and put a chalkboard and started teaching, and everybody who would see me under an avocado tree and I would call it a school, everybody would say, this young man is crazy. But I persisted, I was committed, I had the idea, and I thought I would make it, and I made it for sure. So I started teaching these children something that is not common in Uganda or in Africa is young children may not learn how to read at an early age of about maybe 7 years or six. So it's what I did at an avocado tree, and people started referring to the school as a disabled school. So I thought I had an issue again to address within the community, to teach the community what are the causes of disability and how can it be avoided, what do we need to do, what should be the community involvement. So I had an outreach program to teach people, and people would even hide their children who have disabilities because they know it is like a curse. People would think you did something bad and the ancestors cursed you. So at most, other parents would kill children so that they get rid of maybe what they would think are useless people. So when I set up and I began teaching these children, the project became a very expensive plan. And of course, with the stigmatization that was coming up, the disabled school, the people who can't help themselves and so on, I said, okay, it is simple. We should have the community getting involved. Like when we go up with our outreach programs, other parents open up to begin bringing children when they see a change in the children that already we had by then. So when they bring them up, we teach them, and at an early age they are able to read. They would take readings in church at the age of about 7, 8. And then the committee said, oh, you mean the disabled school can create change? So they said, how can we bring our children to school? Because there is something good. I said, it is simple. We sat down and we calculated how much their children would contribute to meet the feeding, to meet the books, and other scholastic materials. But at the back of my mind was, when we admit 10 children who are normal, then what they bring in would cater for an extra one child who has a disability. In 2007, it was 5 would cater for one. Currently, we use a ratio of 3 to 1. We have a total of about 502 children who come to school every day, and 178 are children with different disabilities. But of course, as the project grows, you get a lot of challenges. I call them opportunities, not challenges. Those are opportunities for you to think ahead of time, and then you see how you move on. So the first challenge, I had this fancy kitchen at school. By the way, most schools were even, why do you destroy, bring down such a very fancy kitchen? This kitchen, it did a lot of environmental destruction. Every time we would use about 6 trucks of firewood, would cut down trees to come and prepare food for the children. You can imagine the amount of environmental degradation that we did. And our cook had written on the entrance, enter at your own risk. You can see the other places, the fire everywhere almost. So when we began the partnership with Drake University, when they reached there, they said, is this a kitchen? I said, yes. He said, no, this is not a kitchen. So the argument was, is it a kitchen or not? And were it people arguing over an inverted 6? Somebody standing the other side will call it a 9, and somebody standing this side will call it a 6. So is it a 9 or a 6? So what we did with the partnership, we had a new kitchen constructed by Drake University. The cook stoves that are improved, no smoke. That means even the health of the people working in the kitchen improved. And so that was something very good. Then the water system, because we did have clean water system. And then scholastic materials, we have a library here. Over there we have Evelyn, who has just sat for her national examinations to qualify to go to secondary. She's blind, she uses a Parkinson's Braille machine. And the ladies and people from the Faculty of Education normally involve in direct classroom teaching, and they experience what it means. In Uganda, we have about 75 different tribes, 75 languages, 75 cultures. Attend one point in a class, you'll find about 45 languages in a class. So how do you teach that? So they have had experience of teaching such a class, and then you understand each other, and then life moves on. Then here I have my football team that has defeated so far twice, the team of Drake University. And those are very young, talented boys. They know how to play and football and soccer, not American football. It's very difficult for them. And then here is where we want to go. Other people call them challenges, but I prefer calling them opportunities. The first picture here, we have teachers. What they go through is when they need to do something for children who are blind, they have to transcribe. One reads and another one is writing manually. Maybe transcribing a book of about 50 pages, which would take us maybe 2 weeks or 3. And then maybe we teach about 7 subjects. So then the next slide, a photograph is for one of our children in class, uses a Parkinson's Braille machine, and other different types of disabilities. For those who have been there, we have those with Down syndrome, autism, those who are deaf, and different categories. But the challenge we have when these children finish school, with this one here, we want to make sure the center for transcribing materials for children with the vision impairment. That is our vision as far as this picture is concerned. Then the second one, when our children go to when they join secondary, very few people accept the approach of inclusion, that people can be instructed together. A school is beyond just learning to read and write, but it comes with a social component, interaction, making friends, and learning what happens. People have never asked themselves that, for example, if you don't know what happens with people who have different disabilities, what if one time you become disabled, where do you begin from? Because I understand all of us, we are potential candidates to disability. Anytime something can happen, and you become disabled. And the better you understand what takes place in the world of people who have impairments, the higher chances for you to. So in secondary education, people don't use that approach. So we find a problem, and it is a gap that we also see or an opportunity lying ahead of us that we can bridge. The next one is, I normally teach children, how do you skills, how can you make a table, how can you make a chair, how can you make this, with the hope that when they go out there during maybe the holidays and so on, maybe they can do something, and then it can be in position to support them, and it is a skill that can develop. And perhaps they get, at the extreme end, we have chicken. We normally teach children how do you rear chicken. And maybe a child can start putting up a small farm and so on, and then maybe can sell it and can get money. But all these, we do them through involvement. That's why with the Drake University, when people go there, we share experience, we share the knowledge, and then we also go and talk to the people in the community, then we find that we are really doing a very positive direct impact on the lives of human beings, and we are proud. And I would call everybody in this room, you join us in the move to make a change in the lives of people that are having a series of challenges in catching up with education. Thank you.
So I wanted to tag on very briefly because we have two professors here with us tonight, Professor Jimmy Sendeza and Professor Deb Bishop, both from the College of Business and Public Administration, who are part of a team of faculty who have been leading Drake student delegations to Uganda for how many years now?
10 years.
And it's been our most successful Drake-led faculty travel seminar. But the service is always a part of the project, and the faculty and students who have been on these trips are now also engaged in what we call a Global Pressing Issues grant project that the Nelson Institute here at Drake funded to address water quality issues in a village in Africa, in Uganda. One reason I wanted to mention this is because students in the audience, this is an opportunity that you can take advantage of. I don't know if you have any for this next spring, if you still have any openings, but every year the faculty do lead a trip to Uganda, and so you could go and visit Francis and his see his school in person if you have the interest. So, and later, perhaps during question and answer, if you guys want to tag in and add some other insights or.
Well, David just took my presentation for me.
Oh, no, I'm so sorry.
I'm kidding. Well, thank you. This is just so fun to be a part of this panel and to hear of the different ways that Iowa is engaged with the African continent, and specifically to hear Drake mentioned the number of times that it has been. I think you have a brief picture of our engagement in the continent, but. Just really briefly, I won't bore you with a lot of the abstract here, but just to reinforce to you, Drake's mission does include preparing our students for responsible global citizenship, and it's something we take very seriously. And a number of the programs and things I'll be talking about tonight really demonstrate our commitment to that mission and also to our vision of serving as a global knowledge hub. And I'll just talk a little bit about the visibility and connections around the world and how we engage interculturally, just as two sort of main points tonight. So you've heard about our some of the work we do in Uganda, which I'll talk about a little bit more in depth here, but we do have 23 university partners around the world, and three of which are on the African continent. Our partner university with Makerere University Business School in Uganda is our longest standing African partner. That was established in 2007, and we'll actually be celebrating our 10-year anniversary in Kampala in Uganda in January. And so Provost Madison here from Drake University, along with myself and the professors in the room and a few others, will be there to celebrate that anniversary. That particular program started as a student-led trip, as David mentioned, through the connection with Professor Santeza. And we have been taking 20 students, approximately 20 students every year, to Uganda for a three-week program on sustainable development. And while our students are in country, they're paired with 10 students from Makerere University Business School, so 10 Ugandan students, and they have this side-by-side true intercultural experience for the 3 weeks. And they engage in work along with community partners such as Francis's school. And I'll say I had the pleasure of visiting Francis's school twice. And it is just everything that you saw and more. It's just an incredible experience for our students to engage in community service in that way. And several of our student teachers have the opportunity to actually teach in the school while they're there as part of that three-week experience. So the one quick thing about that particular program that we've been able to do is then bring those same 10 Ugandan students that are on the program with our Drake students to Drake for about 10 days. And so they will be here in February and for sort of a full circle reverse perspective program, which is something that we're really proud of and excited about. We also have faculty doing research collaboration and have had a strong relationship with the embassy in Uganda as well. The other two partners are more recent. The University of KwaZulu-Natal, I guess, was also in 2007. That partnership has been a real focus for some of our faculty here at Drake. We have a lot of joint research going on with that university, but we also have taken students as part of that. We have a student exchange agreement on file for those of you that might want to spend a semester in Durban in South Africa. You can do that as part of our student exchange agreement also in Uganda as well. Addis Ababa University is the most recent partner that we have. That was established in 2012. And that was through our College of Pharmacy and Health Sciences. And we, again, it was established primarily around faculty research. And we're looking to broaden that partnership in years to come. We have also had faculty doing research in Rwanda and Mali and have led short-term courses to Egypt, Ghana, Rwanda, and the Tanzania experience through Empower Tanzania through Phil's organization. So one program I will highlight on the inbound side of things is The most recent engagement we've had with Sub-Saharan Africa was that we were selected as a host for the Mandela Washington Fellowship of the Young African Leaders Initiative. And those of you that may have been around in the summer have hopefully heard about this program. Drake was one of 36 universities in the country that was selected as a host institute. It's a U.S. Department of State and White House program that I hope will continue. And there were 1,000 fellows across those 36 institutions this past summer. There were 40,000 applicants from across Sub-Saharan Africa that applied to be a part of the Mandela Washington Fellowship, and 1,000 were selected, just to give you an idea of the selectivity of that program. There were 25 young professionals here on Drake's campus, ages 25 to 35, and they were here for a six-week experience on business and entrepreneurship. Dr. Bishop was the academic co-director of that program, and Professor Sintesa also engaged with the fellows while they were here. They were not only in class during that 6 weeks, but a huge component of the program was engaging with the Des Moines community. So we were actually partnering with about 30 local Des Moines corporations, nonprofits, et cetera, for the fellows to engage in peer-to-peer collaboration, networking opportunities, and also there were 5 community service projects that were a part of that experience as well. So just a couple of the pictures here on the bottom, Ambassador Johnny Carson, who's on our Board of Trustees, he was a former Undersecretary of State for African Affairs under President Obama in his first term. He was here and spent some time with the fellows. The middle picture was all of us at the Des Moines Arts Festival. Cultural activities were also a huge part of that program. And then on the far right, we attended the presidential summit at the end where President Obama actually spoke to all 1,000 fellows. And it was a really sort of momentous occasion there at the end of the program. So that we have applied to be a host institute again for 2017, and we'll find out in probably 2 weeks if we've been selected. So those were the main highlights of our current engagement with Africa, and I'm happy to take questions at the end.
Thank you. everybody. Thank you for joining us this evening, and also thank you to my fellow panelists for being here and sharing your stories with about your organizations, and thank you, David, for inviting us all here for this meeting this evening. I want to talk to you about Medicine for Mali. My name is Dave Mershman. I'm the president of Medicine for Mali. We're a small group out of Des Moines. Was started 16 years ago by Dr. Steve DeVore and his wife and family. And we are still a relatively small organization. We do have some people. Dr. DeVore's wife, after he died in 2008, she moved to Columbus, Ohio, and so her and her family now live in Columbus, and so they have some people and friends there that help us over there in Ohio. We work basically with five different programs in the country of Mali, and Mali is located in Northwest Africa, just on the southern edge of the Sahara Desert, under Algeria. And basically, we have five programs that we work with in some of the villages that are southwest of Bamako, which is the capital. We work with the education, we help with the schools and training the teachers, public health and teaching the young mothers the importance of good nutrition and weighing their babies. Also, we bring medical supplies, and we do team with the Des Moines University when the security is safe, and we bring doctors and nurses and some medical students over there. And then when I joined the organization in the year 2003, I'm in business, I'm not in the education field or the medical field, so we kind of started a microfinance program, and then we also started a clean water program. So I'll talk to you about two of those programs this evening, which are the clean water as well as microfinance. The first program I'll talk about is the microfinance. Basically, what we do is, we have money that we take to these different villages, and currently we have the microfinance program in 10 different villages. And each of these villages are anywhere from 200 to about 2,500 people. And each loan is only in about the denomination of about $50 to $100 each. So they're strictly microfinance programs. But when you consider the average income for a family in Mali is generally $1 to $2 a day. You know, a loan of $50 to $100 means a lot. So 70% of our money when we go to a village has to be given to a woman. And studies have shown that when the women make a little extra money, it goes towards the health and well-being of the family. And one rule that we have when we go to each of these villages, and we've had this microfinance program in place now for 10 years, every single loan must be paid back to us with 5% interest when we return the following year. And if there's one loan that is not paid back, we pull the program from the village. In the 10 years that we've had the program, every single loan has been paid back to us. So the poorest of the poor find a way to pay back their loans. And the women are very clever in some of the ways that they've come up with ways of using our loan money to make profit. And one way that they do it is the basic rule of supply and demand. When they grow the crops in their fields and in their gardens, the food in their gardens, at harvest time, which is generally the same time of the year that it is here in Iowa, in October and November, of course, there's all kinds of food. So what the women do is they live off of the money that we lend to them. They live on that money for about a four-month period, and then 4 to 5 months after harvest time, the price of the food that they normally would have gotten at harvest time, now 4 or 5 months later, is worth double what they would have gotten at harvest time. So they make much more profit on the food that they grow in their gardens and in their fields by using the microfinance loans. Some of the women have used the money to buy some clothing and make dresses to sell. Others have used it to buy ingredients to make soap and then sell the soap. So they've come up with a lot of good ideas. We did not teach them these ideas. They had the ideas. They just needed this little seed money, if you want to call it that, to kind of help them get going and get them on their feet. What it does, it gives them a sense of accomplishment, also gives them an opportunity to set some goals and to achieve those goals. The second program that we work with is in regards to water. When I had a conversation with Dr. DeVore about 3 years before he died, he said, "Dave, we can bring all the medicine in the world over there, but if they keep drinking dirty water, we're pouring our money down the drain." So we just went to the basics, and we go to these different villages after we raise enough money to do so, and we drill wells, and we provide them with clean water. And a lot of times the water that they drink is generally from a hand-dug well. This is one of the nicer hand-dug wells in one of the villages because it has a concrete culvert that's been placed over the opening. Basically, the water is drawn out of the well, and these wells are about 20-25 feet deep. They've been hand-dug, and they've been there for decades, if not centuries almost. That's the color of the water that comes out of most of the wells, unfortunately, and this is what they drink. This is all they know. It's just a lot of different problems that can occur with the dirty water as you, So all of these problems occur with the water, and when we go to a village after we have provided them with a clean well, and the wells that we provide to them are basically just a hand pump, very similar to what you see on an Iowa farm from years ago, and we hire a company out of the capital city to come to the village, and they drill these wells with the steel encasements after the well is drilled, so the water that comes up remains clean. It's the water that I drink when I'm in Africa. I don't drink the water that's in the city. I only drink bottled water in the city, but when I go out to the villages, I drink the water that comes out of the wells that we've drilled because it's bottled water quality. The water is tested ahead of time. We make sure it's clean. After we have had a well in a village, when we go back the following year, the people are so happy because they no longer have the constant stomach aches, the constant diarrhea. I mean, imagine living with that almost every day of your life. I mean, no wonder so many of them get dehydrated and get sick because they just can't keep the fluids in their body because of the diarrhea. So their skin texture and tones is just so much better. Our doctors and nurses are so much happier when they can see much healthier patients coming into the clinic. And just the basic things of clean water just makes a big difference. So again, I'm very proud to be a part of this panel, and it's very exciting and interesting to hear all the different stories, how each of these organizations that might be in a small part of their part of the world are making a big difference in a lot of people's lives. So thank you.
Let's open up and see what questions you have for the panel. Please.
Hi, this isn't really directed at any one person, but when you go over and you're working to build kitchens or to build wells, I'm curious about, I guess, the communication that goes on throughout the rest of the year. For example, building a well, you know, if that well is still the same well that they use in the year, and just the sustainability of the projects that go on in the countries that you're working with, and what does that communication look like, or how does that communication change from year to year if you do change partners or change who the person you're communicating with, what's that look like when you're not
they're
working on the project directly?
Good question.
Well, in regards to our programs with the wells, here's the plan that we tell them. We'll provide your village with a well. the maintenance of that well and the upkeep of that well is your responsibility. So we have a very small group of Africa friends who live in Mali. They go out and they visit the different villages. But the villages have come up with a plan of their own where they put together an organization where they, each village puts in a kitty, if you want to call, they put some money into an organization that if a well does break or something, then they have that money available to fix their well. We do not repair the wells. The well is their responsibility. Again, we're trying to teach responsibility. We're trying to teach them something rather than just a handout.
I'll just really briefly, from Drake's perspective, say that all of the projects that we engage with host community partners is the establishment of key community partners within the host community is critical. And we never would approach a project as a Drake project without engaging the local community for that local buy-in. But I will also say that something really important that the Ugandan, the faculty leading this program have done is that they've actually created a one credit course here on campus for the continued work on the projects from afar, again in communication with our community partners. But there's a one credit class both in the fall and the spring for students to remain engaged in the work on those projects. So a very unique and sort of cutting edge model there, but it gives us a way to remain connected to the host community and to those projects.
Whenever we design a project with the local community, an important part of that is consideration of how we're going to sustain it. The first part is getting an agreement with the community that it's an important thing to do. But the second thing is we require some form of sweat equity in the program. If it's a construction project, then they're part of it. If it's an education program, then while the women are away being taught, other women in the village are doing their chores. That has to be just a key part of it. And as much as possible, we want that to be a given at the outset. Maintaining communication, we're fortunate that we've been able to recruit and hire staff, and they do a lot of the on-site monitoring. Email is an important part of the way we stay in touch. Some of these remote villages don't have access to the internet, and so our staff physically go out and meet with people and try to resolve the inevitable problems. Sustainability is really hard to do. I mean, these programs are expensive, or can be, and a lot of times these people we're working with have never had to think about this sort of thing before, collecting money, saving money for something that they don't really spend it on right now, but they're going to do maintenance in 2 years from now when there's a problem. Many of these are really foreign concepts. And so an important part of, in addition to the program itself, is the ancillary learning that goes on with it to assure that it continues.
I had a question for Moses specifically. I was wondering what the educational model for the schools in Kenya are, like the teaching method and stuff. Is it based on like an American system or a Kenyan model, or just how does that work?
The education system, it's different. And part of that is from personal experience. When I moved here in high school, I was in Kenya, and I transitioned to Valley High School, West Des Moines. And I was learning the same thing, but in a very different way. That's the best way to put it. We find students who can come to the United States or other countries in collegiate level, and they can perform accordingly because you still got the basic education that you needed. But in primary and secondary education, it is done in a different way. The best way I can put it too is there is a cultural aspect that has to be acknowledged when it comes to teaching. I mentioned we've done things like books in Kenya. Many people have asked me, how can I give you books here in America? There's so many books. These libraries that have all these books, people are getting rid of books. Why can't you just take these books to Africa? And so, okay, let's say we get away with shipping cost and everything. Let's say I could get the books to Kenya, right? A Kenyan boy opens a book and he talks about the bear and the raccoon. We don't have bears or raccoons in Africa. We don't. He wants to see a book that's talking about the cheaters and the lions. And it sounds so mundane and stupid, maybe some and silly, but it is the cultural aspect that has to be respected. And so we have to be careful when we're thinking about that, and that's where we rely on teachers who are trained and learn in Kenya to be able to provide this education for the kids so they are successful. So we do have teachers, we do have assistants. The kids just don't have access to go to those schools.
Yes, please.
I've heard the word sustainable a lot. What is the most difficult part of becoming sustainable? The money, the personnel, the type of project?
Yes.
Okay. I just say briefly, in my situation with our organization, it is that. I mean, money is probably the biggest way, the simplest thing you can think of, but you got to think futuristic. You got to think about, it's so easy to think about the now, but thinking about not only next year, but 5 years, 10 years, 20 years is such a big thing when people are living on a day-to-day basis. You're trying to teach a very foreign concept to people who are facing challenges that are so hard to not even consider the future. So that's something that you have to face. But as an organization and people who are trying to help, we have to think of what's the best way to do that. So in our situation, I would say yes, it becomes funding, because a project you might calculate and say, hey, it'll cost $5,000, but you put sustainability to it, it might now become $7,500, it might now become $10,000, you don't know. And now you start thinking, well, could I do two projects at $5,000? Or should I just do that one and make sure that it's there for the next 10 years or 20 years or however long it needs to be? Those are questions that sometimes you have to wrestle with. And then donors might not like that sometimes. They want to see a lot of fruits to their labor very quickly. And you have to fight that and say, no, I want to ensure the people are the ones who benefit the most. So that's just from my personal experience.
If I could ask a question, actually, and Jimmy and Deb, because we've heard that Drake actually has, you know, a relation, has had connections to many of these organizations. I know our faculty have gone to Medicine for Mali with the Drake group. And many of these ties involve students, and you've been taking groups of students to Uganda now for 10 years. So you've seen students graduate and move on to you know, things pass after Drake as well. Not just Drake students, but also the Uganda students. And I'm curious, because we want to make sure that when we're partnering with community organizations, that it's mutually beneficial, right? But from our perspective, it really is the educational mission. We're an educational institution. Our students are our first priority. So my question is, what have you seen in terms of the long-term impact that these kinds of engagements have had on Drake students, you know, either the rest of their educational experience at Drake or after they've left Drake?
Well, you know, oftentimes they'll say that it changed their life. But, you know, how do you see that manifest, I guess, is really the question. And I think mostly, you know, we haven't really followed it, looking at statistics or where did they end up going. But anecdotally, I mean, you see, like, Drew, who now is in global health in medical school, and you see Dory, who's been to who knows how many countries since she was in Uganda. And so you see, I think, that impact, and even with the projects that they're doing and when they're on campus with Francis last night, how many of them came for that event when Francis was speaking to the students with Delta Sigma Pi. So I would like to say that we've changed 200 lives just by giving them a much, much better global perspective, and that it's impacting them as they view the world and as they make decisions about priorities in their lives.
And I would concur. One of the things that we do while the students are in Uganda is we have this journaling that we ask them to do every day. And so we design a small booklet that constitutes the program, different activities that we're going to get engaged in. And so we ask them to describe the activity and then we ask them to reflect on that activity daily. And we have really a chance to read those when we get back here, and those are really telling in terms of confirming that you know, this is a very big change in their lives. And like you said, we really haven't followed students through. But when you look at some of the things that they are, some of them are doing right now, there's two students in Uganda right now. One of them is teaching at the university, okay, University Business School. The other one has been there for a year now. She's she worked for one of our partners, a hotel entrepreneur who was here, I think, 2 or 3 years ago. He came and did a presentation here. You know, those are things that they do. This last summer, Drew went back and spent 6 weeks. He's a medical student now in Chicago. He went back and these they find on them, their own. So he found a hospital in Western Uganda, went and spent time there, and, you know, we just helped them make arrangements, but he's gone 2 years ago already. And in January now we have, how many?
I think there's three or four with us.
Who are coming with us for the 10-year. Yeah. Two of them likely, I mean, if they, one of them I think is booked, but the other one, they were the first set of students who went with in 2007.
They're with you.
Yeah, they're coming back. Yeah. So,
and they're from 10, two of them are from 10 years ago.
10 years ago.
Yeah.
And they now interact on social media with the other with the other students, and we just find out a few things. They get married. We have how many couples now?
And
so
three
so
or
many
four
things
couples.
Happen out of these things that I could go on.
Well, maybe so far my experience is, yesterday I was sharing with a student from Drake University, and basically was asking me when he came to Sure Prospects, she thought at first that if you need to establish maybe something that would create impact, you need to have maybe thousands or millions of dollars to begin something. But she learned that even what you need is just an idea, then maybe a shade of a tree, and then you can begin from there and you go everywhere you need. And she told me she's working on an organization which she has already registered, and then is looking up to how do you write a proposal, how do you do a fundraising, and so on. And like she is already thinking to do much of bigger things and engaging the community or the globe in whichever direction she's planning to do that. And I think that was maybe an inspiration from some of these projects that we do. And I also do believe that I normally get a series of emails from students from here, maybe asking different questions about maybe our projects and about what they could do, about what other aspects of life. I did not talk about when the ladies, the students got to my project. I don't know how they came to realize that even they are not at my school but elsewhere, children in Uganda drop out of school, the girls, because of the sanitary towels. Now, the next time they come to Uganda, they had already made handmade sanitary towels, and they were giving to children and then discussing with other girls, and then they made their own program that even when they go, I normally see them, they collect the girls, they look for a separate room, they go and discuss, and like every other child is happy, and maybe more other. So you find that they really try to do much more than just a mere engagement, going to a project and then looking at what is around and then come back. It's much more than that.
We don't ordinarily do student exchange programs, but we have had, we facilitated relationships between Des Moines University and University of Iowa medical students to go to one of the hospitals in our area. And that's been ongoing, excuse me, for 5 or 6 years, very successful. So the universities are pretty much handling that now themselves directly. But I mentioned earlier that last summer, two students from Drake went. And our philosophy in relating to students has been Tanzanians are, the area we're working in anyway, are too poor to support tourism. We want students who come that can do something useful for the community. They'll get an educational experience, and if faculty have specific assignments for them, we'll try to accommodate that. But we need for them to go and do something that helps the folks that we're working with over there. And in this particular instance, both of them worked with our staff and a group of the women in one of our gender-based violence groups to develop some educational materials and some promotional materials for a future program that we'll be doing. So it was a very valuable experience, taking advantage of their expertise in the English language and in skills and developing some brochures. That's going to be the pattern that we'll be following again with the group next year, working together to figure out what is a useful thing for them to accomplish in the amount of time that they have.
I think we have time for one more question, if someone has one. Yes.
Hi, I'd like to thank all of the panelists. I've really enjoyed hearing and learning from all of you. We are some medical students from Des Moines University, and so a few of you have mentioned partnerships, but we were just curious of what kind of opportunities there could be within the health-related field for medical students to help out.
Well, I just mentioned it. Yeah. See, Chris Katranich at your school, she'll make the arrangement.
We work with her. We're global health
truck
leaders down to the Dominican Republic right now.
We have a clinic in Uganda that we started, Drake University Student Center building. It's a clinic in Uganda 3-4 years ago. And some of the students have shadowed the main hospital that oversees the clinic, and you know they always need people. So those are things that Drake University, I think, can arrange to our medical students, you know, go spend some time in at those places, you know. So, again, the director is over there. She can provide more information on that.
And I would just encourage you, my daughter is a DMU grad. She's an internal medicine doc, and she did the Uganda Makerere exchange, changed her life. So I highly encourage that one.
I was just going to say, once security gets better in Mali, we hope that Dr. Laura DeVore, Laura Delaney, who's at your school. I've traveled with her many times, along with medical students from Des Moines University, but unfortunately, because of Al-Qaeda, and just recently, 2 years ago, it was Ebola, so we're just hoping for things to get a little bit better before your students come back and join us.
And Iris has worked with Dr. Rebecca Shaw, at DMU for the Nigerian Birthing Assistance Program. And that was a partnership with the Rotary District 6000, which is the entire southern half of Iowa. So there's a number of Rotary clubs throughout that district, and each of those Rotary clubs looks at working with different countries and different places. So I think there's going to be opportunities to do the birthing assistance in other countries as well. Originally, when we were working on that project in Nigeria, our thought was to take faculty and students from DMU to Nigeria, but with the State Department travel warnings, they said that's not going to happen, and so we had to kind of skin that cat another way and have the medical professionals from Nigeria come to DMU. But Rotary District 6000 is very interested in seeing this program go to other countries as well. So I'm hoping that we continue working with DMU on that.
I will say, whatever country, organization you go with, if you have the opportunity, do it. I don't know if it's life-changing, but it is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to learn about a different part of the world. And it's just, it also helps you to appreciate that which we are so blessed with here in America.
So some of the organizations have some literature on a table out just outside the auditorium. I'm sure folks wouldn't mind if you'd like to come up and say hi, and if there's any interest in getting involved more in these organizations. It was mentioned earlier that, you know, I asked no fundraising because we want people and students to understand these are free events, and we don't pass the hat. There's no hard sell going on here. At the same time, I these organizations and other organizations Drake partners with do depend upon, you know, the kindness of strangers and friends. And so If you're so inspired, I'm sure that any generosity you can manage would be much appreciated. Thank you all for coming tonight. Thank our panelists. Wonderful work.